Just gotta grab some water. Sorry to delay everyone. The extraction of the developed world, let's be clear on this debate, is currently unsustainable. That means that the question of the debate that is the most important, which team is better able to evade climate change and the global harm that that produces, is the most significant thing in this debate. If you do not, as the developed world, pursue a strategy of degrowth, you will not curb this. You will lead the world to untold disaster. That is why the affirmative team will win this debate. Firstly, how would this be done and why would it work? The aims would be threefold of the strategy of degrowth. And note, obviously, we have some fiat in this debate because it is a short debate. There would be threefold. Firstly, it would be to reduce demand for consumption. So it would be government ad campaigns convincing people they should consume less. It would be prioritizing the maintenance of quality of life while reducing demand. Secondly, it would prioritize sustainability, i.e. finding ways to fulfill people's needs in the way that produces the least sort of environmental and otherwise negative external harms. Thirdly, it would prioritize happiness and people's quality of life as the metric for success rather than the GDP and growth. So material policies that would look like in this debate are a couplefold. In terms of demand, this would look like voluntary reductions in demands of government ad campaigns, but also government policies, like, for instance, banning planned redundancy of products, for instance, iPhones continuing to be re-updated every couple of years, and like them becoming redundant. It would look like aggressive taxes. Second, it would look like sustainable policies, like, for instance, the implementation of carbon taxes. It will look like emission trading schemes. It would look like subsidies for green energy. In terms of happiness, it would look like things like prioritizing a shorter working week, like a four-day working week, which is being tested in New Zealand. It would look like strong labor laws. Fourthly, it would look like a priority on ecological preservation. Why then would this strategy work? The first thing to say here is we believe a huge amount of the current demand in the developed world for consumer goods has been superficially constructed. That is to say, advertising that manipulates people's insecurities so they purchase products, that is to say, malicious ad campaigns and malicious discount campaigns that prioritize people just consuming and consuming. It looks like a culture that prioritizes consumption. It looks like companies like Apple introducing planned redundancies. The reason we fix that is with a team that takes a stab at aggressively trying to curb these things and banning their underlying causes. Our claim is currently people are consuming too much because of this superficially constructed level of high demand. And critically, people don't actually get a benefit out of increased consumption. And the reason to understand this is because of the hedonic treadmill. When people have more, they adjust themselves to having more, and so do not get increased happiness out of that. Secondly, taxing the externalities of industries realigns their profit incentives with their incentive to reduce the externalities. So these policies would obviously aggressively favor the currently existing renewable and sustainable green energy and green technology industries that are currently overwhelmed and have no way or are struggling to break into the market. Why currently, in an environment where governments are prioritizing growth, is it that they don't succeed? Because they are overwhelmed by the current size of the market, by the capture of monopolies, by their higher sale. But also, and I think this is critical, these companies are able to increase their profit margins by virtue of the fact they are risking the external harm that they produce to the environment in terms of increased carbon emissions without an additional mechanism to reduce the emissions that they do. And the thing to understand here is that if we aggressively favor green energy and we aggressively favor renewable industries, that will no longer be a problem. Why is it that the alternative of sustained growth is very difficult? The first thing to just note here is that it's currently failing because currently polluting industries that are huge emitters prefer to do things like, for instance, aggressively cover up their abuses to wash away their external harms with superficial ad campaigns, with lobbying campaigns to politicians, with marketing, rather so that there's no longer a political incentive to regulate them, instead of actually just reducing their external harm. Secondly, because, and this is something that the negative team will struggle to get over in this debate, the scarcity of goods in the world is finite, which means that eventually growth can no longer continue at an indefinite rate, which means that it's pretty unsustainable. Thirdly, the political incentive to maintain growth and get elected is enormous and short-termist. That comes to an end because at the end of this debate, we rely on those incentives, we make them more long-term. Why is the global harm of climate change the most important thing in this debate? Why do we improve the environment under degrowth policies? Firstly, because of less consumption, because people now produce less waste by virtue of the things they consume fully but don't fully consume, we get things like less plastic in the ocean, we get things like less chemicals in waterways, we get less deforestation, and we get less extractive industries that ultimately are negative for emissions. We also tax emissions, leading to basically a collapse of fossil fuel extraction and an increase in green energy industries. The importance of this in this debate cannot be understated, and do not let the negative team do so. Developed countries have the most power over climate change. The first two reasons are they are the biggest emitters. They are approximately 80% of the world's emissions of CO2. And they have, therefore, the most political power to change it. But secondly, their corporations, their multinational corporations, set the global norms of competitiveness around these kinds of things. But the flip side of this is developing countries stand to lose the most from climate change because they have the least capital in this debate to adapt to climate change through adaptive policies, like, for instance, building seawalls. But they are geographically all in the most vulnerable position. Think countries in the Pacific Islands, think low-lying nations in South Asia like Bangladesh. This is the most long-term and most significant harm in this debate. Climate change will destroy people's lives. It will lead to entire nations in the developing world going underwater. It will lead to billions of refugees. If we are the team in this debate that can establish that we curb emissions in a way that is unique, we clearly sail through in this debate. But we say this also benefits to the lives of individuals because decreased in consumption and policies that reorient around people's happiness take a massive blow to capitalist hustle culture. Because in the status quo in the developed world, people are currently being expected to work in increasing numbers. They are now increasingly being expected to work 8 to 6 or 7 to 7 and more than 5 days a week. The harm of this is people are simply so exhausted from work that they do every day. They, you know, have to spend their day off doing all administration and cleaning instead of actually spending it on hobbies and leisure and social connections that actually make their life meaningful. This, to be clear, is an enormous contributor to burnout, to mental illness, to people's global sense of a lack of fulfillment. If we are the team in this debate that establishes billions of people in the world, in the developed world, are just living better lives, I think we sail through. Secondly, currently governments do malicious things to prioritize growth. For instance, they displace and cleanse out areas that are the most poor slums in their cities. They do things like fracking in things that harm the water supply. They do things like setting up extraction projects on indigenous land that destroys indigenous people's connection to their land. That matters in this debate, and we curb it. To be clear, we are the team that actually take climate change by the horns and take it seriously. We must win.
Okay, thank you. Let's have first negative.
For AFT to get up in this debate, they have to stand behind a model that is hardline enough that it actually causes degrowth, that it actually causes economic contraction. So my first response, first piece of extraneous response in this speech will be to explain that they probably don't. Because in order for their model to work, they kind of give us two broad prongs. One, that they're going to have less like damaging kind of emissions causing technologies and industries working, but secondly, that they're going to have much less consumer spending. Note that a lot of countries can put in place emissions reduction schemes, carbon trading, things like that, without causing massive like contractions in their economy. We would point to places in the EU like Germany. So the other prong of their model probably has to operate really strongly to have the material impact that they want. That means that the amount of consumer spending has to drop a significant, like an incredibly significant amount. Because if you're saying that like my demand for clothing is probably artificially created and not particularly important, and as a result of ads, do you know how much less clothing I would need to buy a year to make a material impact on my carbon footprint, and how that would have to be applied across all of the developed countries they want to talk about? We think that the amount of spending that they want to reduce it to probably produces sadness, is probably pretty inequitable, because the people who can least afford this and who are least likely to be able to spend now are poor people. But also, maybe they say, oh, well, the hedonic treadmill means you weren't becoming happier anyway. I don't think that is a sufficient response, because obviously you are still quite sad if now you're getting immense social messaging saying you're a terrible person for all of your consumer spending. Note that the other part of their model, where they say, oh, well, they're going to get rid of things like fracking and terrible carbon emitting technology, is now all just obviously going to be offshored into places even less capable of dealing with it and regulating it. This looks like the developing world that they tell you is incredibly important in this debate. That is obviously needs to be weighed incredibly strongly. So what do they actually have to stand for? We don't think that they can just cherry pick from the info slide. They have to do enough to stand for like a real material economic downturn. We think we probably are the side that can choose to do things. And that's why we would support stuff like emissions reduction, because it doesn't necessarily lead to a massive economic downturn. They would need to tax and then not spend so significantly that they put us almost in austerity. Just quickly also note that stuff like the work week, as they tell you, work weeks are incredibly long, but note they are highly unproductive in most of the industries that their material applies to, like kind of office job industries. They would have to stand for cutting the work week of things like trades, which wasn't something they really talked about. So their most compelling material probably doesn't have an impact on productivity. Note that we stand for developed countries pursuing a sustainable level of growth, probably for the next 100 or so years, until major external factors like population growth and automation are much more easy to understand and assess. We think that this means that we will be able to account for the eventual scarcity that we admit exists, but that is probably further off into the future than they want to tell you. But secondly, we stand for the kind of taxing that heavy taxes they would support to an extent, particularly on high emissions industries. But we want to actively stimulate our economy, particularly renewable industries, by spending. So we think that a strong model of stimulus is likely to get far better outcomes. Firstly, why this policy is terrible for inequality. A couple of things. Inequality is obviously an incredibly significant metric in this debate, because your relative economic position in society can cause you to be massively coerced to experience significant harms and can affect like your ability to choose on all sorts of very important matters in your life. We think that it extends even to things like your impact on politics. We think inequality gets worse because this policy will necessarily have to be implemented in a way that maintains the wealth of elites. This is for a couple of reasons. Firstly, because political and economic elites are often pretty coextensive and so obviously have an incentive to protect their own interests when they're putting policies in place. But secondly, because the elites are obviously much more influential on politics than anyone else, because they can lobby, because they probably know politicians personally, and obviously they can ensure that these policies are put in a way that doesn't significantly damage them. The second reason is that there is an immense propagation of like neoliberal economic ideology. We think this means that their policies are most likely to look like what happens in the status quo, where in order to prevent spending, poor families are told, well, don't buy too many Christmas presents, deprive your children of having something to open on Christmas morning. That is obviously incredibly unkind, but unfair as well. The third thing it looks like is there's less government spending on social programs like welfare. We think they probably have to prop, kind of implicitly supporting the material conditions of austerity. This is obviously terrible. We think that like it's happening currently, but they have to support a pretty Thatcheresque vision of the world in order to achieve the material contraction that they have to stand because of the motion, have to stand for because of the motion. We think like we would note that austerity, even without an attempt to cause a genuine contraction in the size of their economy, has caused the UK to have hundreds of thousands of excess deaths since it was implemented, because of people dying because they can't put their heater on in winter and because the NHS is so underfunded. The fourth reason is that the elites can obviously better survive the consequences of this than poor people, because their assets are likely to be more resistant to this. Things like self-sustaining interest funds, things like having a lot of cash on hand in a way that impoverished people living paycheck to paycheck don't. The fifth reason is that assets and purchasing become significantly less obtainable for poor people. This looks like when you can't commodify other things like investing in mining, probably rich people start to invest in housing more, which means that house prices go up because that is an investment that is seen as stable and continues to exist because everyone is obviously going to need housing. We think that's incredibly bad. And lastly, we think the costs just go up across the economy, and this is awful because it means that poor people are like screwed again and again. They're in a double bind. They are less able to afford things. This is clearly really damaging. The second reason that we think we take this debate is that their policy necessitates or produces a very significant shift to the right, as is empirically evidenced across the world at the moment. We would note that there is an incredibly strong correlation between an economic recession and political change. When people's purchasing power goes down, they want a change because they are feeling the material impacts of this. What this looks like is the way that voters in the Midwest responded to their decreased purchasing power by electing Donald Trump, but also more historically, the way that voters responded in the Weimar Republic when their purchasing power went down significantly because of, you know, the economic conditions at the time. We think what this looks like is that you feed into the material conditions that produce political discontent and disharmony. We think that the boil waiting to burst in the developed country, in developed countries, isn't like a mass socialist revolution. It is that there are underlying sentiments and simmering tensions of right-wing nationalism and populism. This is obviously incredibly bad, and we point to places like Poland where it is already happening. When you exacerbate this, you make that shift worse and you make it more pronounced. What this looks like is cutting again social spending that is really important for the poor people that hurts the most in this debate, inculcating a fear of immigrants because people are already terrified of losing their jobs and they look for someone to blame, and compounding the issues of poverty that we think are incredibly harmful and probably debate winning on our side. We also think probably now you are less generous to countries that require your foreign aid, which is really significant when you consider how much offshoring is going to happen to them, how much they will suffer from this policy. The last reason that we take this debate is because we're the side that gets the best consequences for sustainability. We point to two mechanisms here. Firstly, the most important sustainable technology comes from investment and is, regrettably or not, largely driven by the profit motive. We point to things like the development of really successful high-grade battery technology, which comes because there is a perception that you will profit, either because of increased demand for your material as a company or because of regulations that will force people to use it. We think that when you put massive curbs on the companies, which are often involved in both high emission sectors and low ones, or the transition away from them, you cause a significant damage to the level of investment that they can likely achieve or foresee. We think when people have less money, Tesla thinks they're going to be buying less electric vehicles and is less prone to invest in them. But the last thing is that when companies are squeezed, they have two responses like to an economic contraction. The first thing is a high degree of rent seeking. That looks like squeezing out your competition. That looks like BHP Billiton currently going after a copper mining startup to stop them from challenging them in the copper market, even though they would be better for the environment. But the other thing is dropping all of the excess R&D you do, dropping all of the ESG you do. We think this is obviously incredibly damaging. So proud to oppose.
Great, let's have second affirmative.
All right, can you hear me?
Yep, audible and visible.
Cool. The problem with that speech is that it fails to account for the fact that the environment is a ticking time bomb, that previous policies have been tried and failed, and that the only way for us to fix the number one problem that is occurring globally is to impact the environment to a significant extent. If this negative team cares about civil unrest and the cost of living, those two things are made so much worse when the environment spirals out of control, because poor people are always going to be the first to suffer. On-site affirmative, we obviously bite the bullet. That cost is going to increase in the short term. But that's okay, because one, the trade-off is worth it, which I'm going to explain to you. But second of all, the kind of goods that are likely to increase in price are not things like basic necessities like clothes and food and water. It is things like luxury goods and technological products that are A, less necessity, but B, poor people consume less of anyway. Two questions in this speech. Firstly, let's talk about the model and why our model is not what that negative speaker says, that is, we are just doing current things that already exist. And secondly, let's talk about inequality. Let's start with the stuff about the model, because that speaker tells us that, well, policies like this already exist in the status quo, and we can do things like prioritize sustainable energy, but also have the benefits of increased growth. Four responses to this. First of all, these two things go hand in hand. Demand and the impacts to the environment occur simultaneously. The problem with the status quo is that the only government focus is emissions. So the government's focus in the status quo is, let's put investment into more sustainable types of energy. Let's do things like potentially have a carbon tax. Let's subsidize environmentally progressive industries. But the problem with that is that it does not account for the spiraling consumer demand that exists. What we do on site affirmative is attack both of those things at the same time. And it is only when you focus on both sides of the problem that you're effectively able to solve the immeasurable demand that is causing things like sweatshops and fast fashion that is curbing out of control. Second of all, they tell us that, well, people won't respond, and this small increase or decrease, in my spending and my consuming of clothing isn't going to impact the environment. I think this is just, first of all, mitigation. But second of all, I think that the rhetoric and kind of lines of analysis the government is likely to use is likely going to be incredibly persuasive and powerful. That means that people will opt into it. But second of all, everyone decreasing their demand by 2% is a massive decrease in demand, considering the amount of people that would be responding to this policy. The sheer volume of impact you have are absolutely huge. Finally, on the stuff around that, well, people are now really sad because they aren't able to get benefits from material goods. Five responses to this. First of all, this happiness, as we proved to you at Oscar, is superficial because it is only defined by companies' advertising. When the advertising ceases to exist, you no longer feel like you have to respond to it. Second of all, when everyone reduces their demand, it is a collective experience of decreasing your consumption of goods. That means that those impacts are mitigated. Thirdly, those things are overcome by policies like the short-term work week. So yes, maybe you buy less things, but you also have more time. And the impact of that time is massive because it increases your mental health. It makes you less burnt out. It makes you can do things like involve yourself in the environment. But finally, I would argue that one of the main reasons that young people experience mental health issues and sadness is due to things like climate anxiety. That is statistically and empirically proven. When we are able to do things like have an actual response to the environment where people feel like the government is doing something and they feel like there is actual impetus to change things that are causing them a huge amount of grief, that is obviously going to benefit their climate anxiety hugely. Second of all, let's talk about inequality, because there are three key pushes from this negative team. First of all, this policy is bad because it's still going to pander to the elite. Second of all, things like welfare are going to be the first to go. And thirdly, this is going to play into right-wing rhetoric and prices of goods are going to increase. We have six responses to this. The first thing to say is that we obviously have fear in this debate to get this policy through. So this negative team can't make arguments about how it won't be successful because we have fear to prove that it does. But that's not important. The next five responses are far more important. Secondly, let's talk about political lobbying. Because this team says, well, the wealthy have a huge amount of power. That means they're going to infiltrate themselves into this policy. The problem with this is that under our side, less businesses have incentives to sway the government in the short term because their priorities as businesses change. That means that their metric of success is no longer defined by their short-term growth. Because when the government changes their priorities and changes their narratives, it means that things that matter are things like, one, quality of their employees' satisfaction and happiness. Two, they're lessening externalities to the environment. But three, their ability to pursue that growth sustainably in the long term. When those priorities changes, that means that even if power is given to the elites, the way that elites use that power is far better. But second of all, if we, like, the elites under our side are just going to have far less power because businesses that are deeply unsustainable and exploitative are now deemed less important by the government, the government being the person that has the most amount of power. When the government delegitimizes these huge big businesses to be as important as they are in the status quo, it means that they can no longer be as successful because they are no longer deemed as important. Thirdly, on welfare, the first thing we would say here is that this is obviously not going to be the first thing that the government will cut by virtue of the fact that, one, neoliberal governments actually do have serious electoral incentives to do welfare. But secondly, there are obviously just other things that they would dip into in their budget. We would point to things like defense spending that would be the things to go. But also, welfare and decreasing demand are not that, like, they're not mutually exclusive. We can have welfare spending and decrease consumer demand. Having high levels of welfare doesn't increase people's demand exponentially because the kind of things that they spend on are life necessities that don't contribute to things like inflation. Fourthly, on house pricing, it is obviously a silly argument from this negative team because obviously it is symmetric. There is literally a housing crisis in the status quo. We think that instead of wealthy people doing things like buying up houses, they won't do that. One, because there are just a lack of houses. But two, because now renewables are a more important thing. The government is deeming that renewables are the thing that is going to attract them to sustainable long-term growth. They are likely to invest in these things instead. That is a far better investment and one that we would support on site affirmative. Fifthly, let's respond to the staff about how there's going to be an increased cost in consumer goods and a shift to the right. First of all, this argument is contingent on proving that poor people are hurt under our side. We are going to prove that they are not. First of all, there is obviously, like, the welfare is, this policy is existing in developed places where welfare is already done to a relatively good extent. And so that means that, as I proved to you earlier, the chances of welfare being cut are extremely small. Even if welfare is cut a little bit, we think that this will be backed up by the fact that people's happiness is going to increase and the fact that we have long-term growth that is going to feed back into poorer people in the long and medium term. But second of all, by virtue of the fact that you have less demand, it also means that people are buying less, which offsets the increase in price. So even if prices increase, which obviously they do on site affirmative, that is offset by the fact that people now feel like there is less of a need to increase their demand. But finally, the types of goods that are increasing in price, are things that are not essential. So the kind of goods that people would buy less of are things like clothes, things like luxury goods, things like renewing their technology often. Those things impact poor people far, far less. Obviously, there is inelastic demand for things like food and groceries and electricity. What's the important thing to realize at the end of this speech? This negative team have given us no viable way of increasing environmental benefits. They point to things that already exist in the status quo, which clearly are not working. We give you a unique solution, one that is the only way to sustainably increase economic growth and the environment in the medium term, that improves people's happiness and that actually changes the narrative which the government is perpetuating very far out of the court term.
Great, let's have second negative.
Today's world of governments trying to curb inflation was a really bad context for the average reasonable voter watching this debate, because I think that the average reasonable voter knew what Liv told you, which was that when you have stimulus, when you have people having enough money to live, which is the closest thing that we got in stimulus in the COVID pandemic, people will spend money. When people spend a bit too much money, we have inflation. Then the government tries to curb inflation by doing things like raising central bank interest rates, or alternatively taxing, or alternatively taking away those subsidies. And that leads to lower discretionary spending, higher default rates on mortgages, and the types of inequity that Liv wanted to talk to you about. But note, panel, that unfortunately, their case was a lot worse than the status quo, because that is what governments were doing when they were trying to reduce inflation by a little bit, when they were trying to curb the rate at which it was going, not when they were trying to do something unprecedented, which was causing a recession and causing an economic contraction. The problems that happened when economies contracted in general weren't able to be waved away by an advertising campaign from Side Affirmative. They were things that required substantially more movement. What did they have to stand behind? If they were going to say that we were going to be coercive on emissions companies, a relatively like, you know what, like coal, gas, all of these other things, which do make up the brunt of emissions that they wanted to talk about, I would have a few things to note. That firstly, you actually had to that wasn't going to be enough to cause the generalized economic downturn that they wanted to talk about, that you probably had to do a little bit more, but also, we could probably do some of those things better. And I'll get to this more in my point about environment, because not only could we tax emissions companies, but we could actually turn around and throw that money back into the economy. We could give it in stimulus, we could give it in subsidies, and we could actually do things like they wanted to gesture to from First Affirmative, subsidize green energies. Like, how much can you subsidize green energies when going at like non-green energies is your only means by which you've given yourself to cause economic downturn? Two questions in this speech, firstly on inequity, then on the environment. Firstly on inequity. Okay, so they have a few responses to the material Liv gives you. The first one is, we have a level of fiat so we can show this policy goes through to an extent. We can show you what is required by the policy itself, as I've gestured to in my introduction, which is why that was an uncompelling response. The second one is, the government's priorities will change. Ergo, the priorities of elites change. No, elites have static profit incentives. Liv tells you what then things like the economy downturns, you end up doing certain, like having certain nefarious impacts on inequity. That's because, say, richer people are more impervious to economic downturn, especially the hyper elites, because they have things like asset bases in things like housing, which has relatively inelastic demand, because they have access to things like wealth, like self-sustaining investment funds, which can weather economic downturns. The people who you harm the most are the poorer. But even were it the case that the elites were going to not be harmed that much or be harmed to the same extent as poor people, we thought that that didn't change the fact of their own incentives to avoid that harm upon themselves. Do it through the fact that they often were politicians, related to politicians, that they were lobbyists, that they were already had the power to coerce governments, to influence governments in how that was impacted. The next push they get is to say that, oh no, you can't reduce welfare. We already have welfare. Governments won't do that. Once again, I think that this comes down to a question of like how stimulus works and how demand influencing works. Because like, sure, maybe you buy the big clash in this debate about the economy is like, does influencing people about Xmas hampers really work or not? But I thought that the reason why the governments got so desperate around Christmas time and said, please don't send, please, 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 is because they recognized that that was never going to be sufficient. It was the best that they could do to try and put a little bit of cap on the outrageous growth rates that led to inflation, but alternatively to curb them more, mind you, we're happy to stand by curbing them a bit more, as Liv told you, but to curb them to the extent that they would go down requires coercive metrics to an extent, or at least a more stepped out model from them. The next thing that we get is, oh no, houses are going to be the same because there's already a housing crisis. Is it just inconceivable to this affirmative team that the housing crisis could get worse when you already had a very high demand for those houses, when you had certain parties with more money, and when you had those properties like not increasing themselves in propagation like other businesses do? I think the analysis from Liv there stands. But I'm going to extend on this in more reasons inequity gets bad. I think you have a generalized reason to recoup more monies from the products you were selling, because the only people who contractions affect isn't just consumers, it's also the people selling goods, because the people selling goods are also consumers, which is why they raise the prices of everything, including water and food. Where did you think your apples came from? They weren't coming from the magic like factory man. They were coming from people people who are subject to the same economic conditions as the rest of society. The next thing that I want to say is that I think that when wages are depressed in real terms, that you also just don't have the ability to like go out as much. You don't have the ability to as easily meet the educational requirements of your children. Your ability to affect social mobility, economic mobility for yourself was reduced. I think that those are real harms, not just, oh, you don't want like superficial vanity products, which Liv tells you, you probably do want as well. The next thing that I'm going to say on this is that I think that you actually have a greater reason to commodify static resources, not just housing, but also things like water when there's economic downturns, which is often why economic downturns precipitate that type of commodification, because you're trying to recoup some of your like some of your surplus where you can, to the extent that you're able to under these new hostile government conditions. At that point, we were way ahead on the economy. But let's talk about the environment, because I think the hand-in-hand analysis that we get from affirmative was insufficient, and it's a bit too late to pair it back from third affirmative. Who best stimulates environmental industries? I think there are some reasons that Liv gives you some of them. I'm going to step it out a bit further, why the conditions for growth for these like industries are best achieved under size negative. The first is that excess spending within companies is often directly related to, say, the R&D projects that they do for green technologies. The second is that non-green technologies are well-developed industries. The reason that you see movement in like green industries right now is because they're a comparatively untouched industry, one that coincides with economic growth that leads to a boom in the economy. Companies are trying to get first mover advantages that you necessarily can't have when you have a contraction-driven economy. The third is that I think that when you first introduce certain technologies, for example, solar panels and maybe in the future better batteries, buy-in from individual consumers is really necessary to get those technologies off the ground, and they are more expensive in the short run. So when you reduce consumers' incentive and ability to buy those luxury goods like solar panels 10 years ago, you inhibit the ability of those groups, even with government subsidies as they had 10 years ago, to get off the ground. Next question on the environment, who gets better regulations? Because I think the difference between our teams were that obviously we could have economic, like environmental regulations, as many countries in the world that are still growing do, like Costa Rica, like Germany. The difference is that when we had an emissions trading scheme, we could reintroduce the money that we made off of that directly into subsidies for green technologies, directly into incentives, the carrots for the company and for the market that we're already dealing with to do things like make the world better for climate change. That was going to be really important because they had to reinvent the wheel, which was comparatively more difficult. But the third thing here is to say in environment, don't let them get away with saying the developing world like has more emissions, because look at the trajectories. The developed world is going down in emissions, developing world is going up. Because although it is true that, say, Vanuatu and Bangladesh have the greatest incentives to avoid climate change, it was also true that places like Nigeria and China had the most to gain from increasing emissions technologies, had the most to gain from growing their economies. That was especially the case in Africa. I thought that it was likely that you push some of these most pernicious industries to the developing world, which is why it got a lot worse in their side of the house. At the end of that point, they don't win on the environment, and they're very, very far behind on inequity and on the economy. Finally, on happiness, I think Liv's responses about productivity not being linked in the way they claim it is already get over this. And I think that my material in inequity sort of just like doubles down on that. Very proud to oppose.
Great, thank you for that. Let's have third affirmative.
Hello, can I be heard?
Yep, audible and visible.
Thank you. Look, side opposition is right that they were kind of supposed to make an argument that this would increase the price of consumer goods. But the argument that is actually made, and check your notes in this debate, is one that businesses will want to recuperate their losses with higher profits. And I'm like, damn, businesses want more profits. Who would have guessed? Our argument is that there is way less demand for goods now, right? There's way less food waste when we have significant campaigns to reduce that. There is way less plastic waste when there's less consumerism and less planned redundancies. There's way less landfill as people consume less goods. And the fact that there's less need for plastics means that there's less need for oil to be drilled out of the earth to produce that plastic. And I'm like, okay, doesn't less demand lead to lower price of goods? Which seems to be an argument that side opposition never grapples with in this debate. And it's why we went off their own metric of actually increasing class mobility and income for those who are poorest. So I'm going to start with that question. Why do we win on their own terms? And then why do we resoundingly win on what actually mattered in this debate, which is the tremendous social and environmental harm that only we proved the first affirmative. The core argument is, as I explained in my introduction, is that they don't respond to our argument that less demand actually reduces the cost of goods. And particularly seeing as the current context is that of a serious supply shortage where companies cannot realistically fulfill demand, it seems incredibly important in the long term that we reduce demand such that prices can come down, seeing as there will be greater political and geostrategical volatility between China and the US, that there will be a greater limitations on supply chains, that the world is becoming more protectionist. But the second response is, in their best case, where it does go up for reasons that they certainly don't provide in their first two speakers, I think their best analysis maybe is the stuff on like businesses now offshore into the developing world because there's less demand in the developed world. The problem with all of this analysis is if it is true that businesses offshore and start getting manufacturing in developing countries instead, it just seems like you're going to get significantly cheaper goods in those countries. And that is a benefit. It's a benefit that is far more important than the harm of, the consumer goods in developed countries increase a little bit, because as they themselves point out, there are existing welfare structures within developed states that mean they are far more likely to be able to access those goods, whereas it is a benefit that in the poorest countries, people have cheaper goods. The next response is, let's avoid the question of the price of consumer goods, and let's just talk about the amount of welfare that occurs, because the argument they make is twofold. Firstly, they argue that there will be less stimulus and less spending. And this was bizarre to me, firstly, because we are the affirmative team and we can fiat that degrowth will not look like less stimulus spending. But their second response is one of, but business incentives and the political elite will push for less stimulus spending under their side, under our side. And the problem with this is I was like, why on earth is it in a business's incentive under a degrowth model where you're already facing less demand to then lobby the government to do austerity? This seems like suicide if you're a business, because you urgently still need to retain some degree of profits. So of course, if it is true that there are wealthy, influential business leaders under their side, the way they respond to this degrowth model is to do the thing that they still can push for, which is increased spending and on welfare, on support for people who are the poorest, such that they continue to spend to some extent. And that is why they cannot get around the stuff that we fear in this debate. And their attempt to explain how businesses react badly just seems bizarre to me because they never step it through. Their last response here is, but this will be politically toxic and will lead to some forms of backlash. They never really impact why it's important, why these groups have significant sway, why it's in these businesses' interest to do this type of backlash. But we give two responses to this already regardless. First, that this backlash is short-term. These companies adapt business models. They recognize it's no longer in their interest to rapidly gobble up as much market share under the promise that they're going to get more customers, under the promise that they're going to be able to reach more people, because demand is no longer as central a part of their business model. And what do they do instead? They recognize they need to retain a smaller share of the market because the market, the demand is not increasing as much, and to retain those customers. And that's why you get some of the brands that now promote significantly harder on brand loyalty, on ensuring that people return to those brands with higher quality products at a cheaper price such that they are loyal. And also it leads to less monopolization, because under their side, when the promise of demand will always increase, growth will always increase, the speculation of we want to gobble as much of the market share as possible is what justifies the enormous losses that Amazon or Facebook can incur in the short term under the promise of it's going to get better in the long term. That's a justification they can no longer give to their investors under our side. That's why you get less monopolization and less unsustainable sustainable models. Businesses aren't just angry, they adapt in ways that are beneficial under our pace. But the last thing is, if it is true that under their side, there are incredibly wealthy political elite and business elite that are benefiting significantly from the suffering of people on the ground and the exploitation of their environment, we say we fix this long-term political capital problem. We strip these people of the profits that they're unduly gaining at the expense of other people. And that is not just a principal good, it alleviates future change and makes change that they themselves want to claim in this debate more plausible. Last, they argue wealthy people reinvest less. And I'm like, what? First, if it's true they offshore, they reinvest in companies in the developing world instead now, that seems like a benefit. And like, oh, boo-hoo, they make a little bit less money now. The way they try to impact this is property prices increase, but they misunderstand our response to this. The reasons why it's symmetric is that the ratio between construction and development on the supply side is currently significantly out of tilt with the demand of property prices, which is what it's driving prices up. And we don't change the ratio of supply and demand by these people reinvesting elsewhere. They invest in housing developers and construction companies under our side as well. So they don't change the housing crisis under their side. Last, at the end of this question, I certainly think we get better, lower cost of consumer goods in the developing world, which wins this debate on its own. But even if that is untrue, it's really, really unpersuasive to me that they're going to get massive like layoffs and unemployment and significant losses of income in this debate. And as such, you ought to prioritize what is far less contentious in this debate, which is there is a significant environmental benefit. And they try and mitigate this by explaining emissions trading schemes exist regardless. They are currently totally failing because they do not address the problem. The problem is that people are demanding too many goods. The problem is that people are wasting a huge amount of things that just end up in landfill. The problem is that governments care exclusively about growth and GDP, not about the environmental suffering that these companies cause to people on the ground. So they don't fix the problem that we very clearly set up at first and exclusively give analysis to how we reduce demand, how we actually encourage businesses to change their practices, how we realign political incentives to actually favor the environmental transition. Literally no response. And the last thing is to note here that yes, emissions trading schemes do exist in some countries, but note we immediately get the US, which is a huge country under our side, and critically is synergistic with less demand. When the wealthy oil companies are making less profits now from less demand, this asymmetrically encourages them to transition under emissions trading scheme. So they work hand in hand, even where they do exist. The last thing that they push is there are less renewables now as well from less demand. What? There is still a demand for energy under both sides of the house? And the far more significant thing is not that less people are purchasing energy. The far more significant thing is that you now have a competitive field against your competition, that you now can reinvest with certainty that there will be a market for you, that you will not be outcompeted by the short-term political incentives to access donations from that oil company. And that was why, even if you believe this response that there is a little bit less demand from energy, that is still an environmental benefit. Renewables are only good because they sustainably provide energy. So this is literally pure mitigation under that side. It's why we hands down win on protecting the most vulnerable people from climate change. We handily win this debate.
Great, let's have third negative.
The problem with team affirmative in this debate was a fundamental misconception of what actually motivated people to spend, what actually motivated them to do things like be good on environmental policy, in what specific sectors and in what specific instances they were likely to invest in the types of sustainable technologies that encouraged growth and that mitigated everything bad that was happening in the climate. Because it wasn't true that we were currently at the point where the only thing and the best thing to do was solely decarbonization. It wasn't true that if only developed countries pursued a policy of decarbonization, it would be enough to offset the increasing trajectory of carbon emissions in other parts of the world. It was not true that the metric they tried to establish in this debate on environment, which was to say that we decrease the amount of consumption and decrease the amount of emissions, ever worked for them, because that wasn't going to fix the environmental crisis. We tell you from first, the way that you fix the environmental crisis is a mutual and incremental approach of increasing the sustainable technologies that actually allow for a better environmental outcomes. It was investing in the type of battery technology that allowed things like solar panels and wind technology to exist properly at scale. It was investing in the types of products that allowed for the mining and extraction of resources with a minimal amount of environmental damage. It was all of those things that you needed a stable economy to do, that you needed stable incentives for producers to do. They never get any of that. They lose on the environment conclusively. Three issues in this speech. Firstly, on cost and the economy, do prices go up or not? Secondly, on the environment and weighing out the impacts of that. And lastly, on the political impacts of this. On that first point about the economy, they try to tell you, well, actually, like, demand goes down, so therefore prices go down universally. A couple of responses and things they just don't really get in our case. The first was to say that you have a universal increase in the prices of goods because you increase things that exist further down the supply chain. If you increase raw materials, irrespective of whether or not it was a luxury good or like a stable or inelastic good, you had an increase in prices because of the way that supply chains worked. Secondly, you have a preemptive like contraction of the economy, which is to say that people who exist in companies preempt that things are going to get less, have less demand, they depress wages proportionately because they increase the fact that they expect the fact they're going to have a decreased demand for those goods. But thirdly, and this is an important factor that they never actually contend with, we win this debate conclusively on this point alone, which was to say that in industries for which you had inelastic demand, things like water, things like housing, things like food, you have an increased concentration of commodification and those interests. That was to say that when you couldn't have speculative industries and trade on financial instruments for other things like other minings and raw materials, you concentrate those interests and the interests of the wealthy on things that people actually needed to survive. You have an exponential increase in those types of industries. That's what happened in Chile, where you have the privatization of water and people were literally constricted to drinking like a gallon of water a day or like less than that and surviving on things that were absolutely like egregious. We think that under their side of the house, they never contend with this. We think that it's something that they lose this debate on conclusively. But what else do they tell you? They tell you on things like stimulus, they have the act to say that they wouldn't do it. I think that what they actually had to do in this debate was prove why this policy, when implemented in the various different like political climates and situations in the world, would lead to good outcomes. They could not fiat the fact that it would have good implementation. We tell you that the way in which like you have corporate capture of the governments, you have oftentimes quite corporatist incentives, means that the types of things you cut spending for aren't things that are good for poor people, but are things that are good for poor people. Things like welfare, things like the protection of water, things like the protection of like key industries. That was what happened. That was where their fiat did not protect them from. But the second thing to say there is that obviously you have things like taxation that come into this debate. And this was important because we tell you that the type of taxation you're likely to cut are things that impact consumers and not people who own capital and have the most wealth in aggregate. We think that those things are likely to be particularly pernicious, even if they tell us they're not going to directly cut welfare in all instances. But then they try to come out in third and say, well, obviously if the wealthy people are dependent on people consuming, they're not going to cut welfare because that destroys them too. Obviously wealthy people have the capacity to kind of disalign their revenue streams in a way that they could just earn money off of like financial instruments, trading things that weren't tied to like actual real assets. We think this probably happens a lot in like in terms of like speculative industries, but obviously it also just happens where you have the case of like the housing market, people increasing the leveraging and the trading of those assets in a way that locks out poor people and we're in an industry that is already quite preclusive to them. That was really bad. That really led people to like losing their houses. That disproportionately impacted minorities who were oftentimes in the most precarious housing situations on net. At the end of this, I think that you should probably believe that maybe in the short term, you have decreased consumption for certain goods. Maybe that was luxury goods in certain instances. But what you should also believe is that the inexorable financial incentives to make profits led rich people to commodify industries that poor people needed to survive. Water got more expensive, food got more expensive. At the point at which you had a conditional and proportionate decrease in wages because you had less production and consumption, poor people's wages decreased. The outcome of that equation was poor people are poorer, the things that they need to survive are more expensive. That was something we won this debate on conclusively. Secondly, on the environment, what actually happens here?
Okay, I think the important thing to understand is the metric that they specifically try to hinge their case on. That was to say, they had mitigation of climate change, they had some decarbonisation, they decreased the demand and consumption of goods. A couple ways they end up knifing themselves to solve other issues in their case. They try to tell you that it was good if the things moved to the developing country, because that means that they get like the discursive economic benefits of that, but you also didn't have like any bad climate outcomes. Obviously, it was worse that these companies operated in places that had regulatory capture, that had worse environmental standards, that meant that the dumping of waste materials that were bad for the environment could not be monitored. It meant you did not have the kind of like meteorological infrastructure to test the amount of like climate change that was occurring by virtue of those companies. But secondly, to say, but obviously you could not win this the case on the environment by simply proving some incremental changes for decarbonisation. That was because we were at the point at which you needed to do other things like investing in sustainable technologies. You needed to have the types of startups that were currently trying to operate in copper mines to extract those resources in a way that didn't have perilous adverse side effects for the environment. You needed all of that additional technology in R&D. The case was whether or not companies were more inclined to invest in those types of things in instances where you cut their bottom line, in instances where you fundamentally cut their capacity to do that. We tell you that that's not what happens. They don't take risks on things that are new, on technology that is sustainable, on things that require investment and some degree of speculation. They concentrate and bunker in on fundamental industries. You never prove that mining completely stops under your side of the house. You at best prove that like you have a limitation of it, but you do not prove that you have the thing that you need, which is to say that you invest in technology that actually allows for the mitigation of that. But note the fact that we don't tell you that we just support the status quo. And this was a really, really important part of our case they entirely miss and mischaracterize. We tell you that we support active funding and the stimulation of renewable technology industries. We tell you that we support diverting things that we tax and taking out into industries that are actually going to help us fight the implications of climate change. But we also tell you, and this is quite important, that they're new to the current trajectory of more sustainable consumer practices, which is to say that consumers are currently trying to allocate their capital in a way that means that they aren't harming the environment. At the point at which they are poorer, which they obviously have to take in this debate, they cannot do that. At the point at which people preempt that people will be poorer in the future, they do not increase, like they do not introduce products into the market that are in their like most nascent stages more expensive because they're sustainable, but over time become more like affordable. They do not win on this environment point. They do at best prove that you have a slight mitigation in the developed world. They don't prove that they mitigate it in the developing world. They don't prove that you have the incentives to create renewable technologies and industries. But lastly, on politics and what happens. At the point at which you have a recession, which is obviously what you have at the economy-wide scale, at the point at which people become poorer and have less demand, obviously what they have and they concede to. But secondly, even if you just don't believe that things get worse in the economy-wide, you still have to believe in this debate that certain key manufacturing towns and certain industries, which oftentimes are the drivers for popular sentiment, get worse off. You shut down all of those rural Midwestern towns that are most likely to get captured by demagogues, that are most likely to get captured by populism. The actual impact of that was that you decrease protractedly and in the long term, and this is important framing for us to why we extend the margin, you decrease all of the incentive and political will to do things that are actually good for all the things we care about. You decrease the will for environmental policy that comes after this point. You decrease the will for foreign aid to developing countries that they rely on for subsistence and things that are very important. You increase all of the fascist tendencies that are currently kind of brewing in society, you increase all of that grievance and mostly say the minorities are stealing your jobs, that the reason first why we are in an economic contraction is the woke ideology of policymakers who do not care about you, want to shut down your jobs and only care about the environment. We're so proud to win this debate.
Great, let's have Megat the reply.
Affirmative gets it very wrong when they try to have their cake and eat it too. What do they tell you on inequity? They give you a few things, a few premises, which don't really string together and which allegedly lead to contradictory outcomes. They tell you there's going to be no cut to the amount of money that poor people are going to have spend in the economy. They tell you that somehow there are going to be lower prices of staples, but raised prices on luxuries. And they tell you that these are going to be caused by sanctioning emissions technologies and advertising, things which many states do and which weren't enough to lead to overall contractions to the economy, which point out the few severe flaws in their pushes back on inequity. The first is that they never stood behind a contraction. And Third Affirmative thinks that Affirmative gets away with this when they say, oh, no, they haven't proved contraction, but like, you know, like, I think we did, and saying that, oh, they need to do more to prove what we agree would likely be the case isn't an effective response. But the second thing that I think is the big problem there is that how does a contraction even if you stand behind it, lead to contradictory outcomes for the demand of consumers on the ground and for the way that they engage in the economies. Because what we recognize from negative, that the way that you led to a contraction, the way you led to a planned reduction in the size of the economy, was by curtailing things by demand, which is why that they had to stand behind a fair bit more than they were willing to. But unfortunately for them, it doesn't really matter because we win this debate anyway. We give you reasons that are necessarily attached to any form of contraction, which even if we didn't prove is the motion, things like how you get preemptive contracting from companies, things like how you get the commodification of inelastic goods and why that is so bad for inequity, things like how less spending leads to a worse quality of life for those whose spending was already tied up in the things that they needed to live when they didn't have that type of discretionary makeup budget that Affirmative wanted to wave around. But let's just say that they bite the bullet on inequity, or let's just say that they win. I think that the bigger win from side negative is actually on their win condition, the environment. Because what do we hear from both sides of the debate on the environment? Their big push on why they get green technologies is, so we make it like more secure for green renewable technologies to be invested in and to be built up, because we are punishing emissions like companies. We are punishing companies that are doing the worst actions for climate change. What we tell you from Liv, and we stand behind explicitly in all three speeches, is we can also punish. The difference is we can punish and then have to reinvest that money in carrots, in subsidies, in the types of things that were linked with the technologies that uniquely attacked climate change, the things that we did not yet have to deal with, that we did not yet have to deal with that big crisis sufficiently. Because they needed to stand behind, note, more than what they were saying they were going to stand behind. But even if they did, we could do the same, but bigger, because what the motion compelled them to defend was the overarching plan on the economy and these different things as components of how you reach that effect. Note, we could still have similar effects if we framed them differently with the equivalent amount of fiat a negative team has when affirmative team has fiat, which is why the fiat waving flag from third and probably reply was never going to work. But even if you don't buy that, I think that once again, they knife themselves. As Sierra points out when they say, oh, like developing world, if it goes there, that's a big win for us because they get more goods. But they've spent a lot of time telling you why goods are unimportant and also why climate change is the most important. And it seems that then like they get more like bad things for the developing world and less impacts on climate change, especially given the context we give you down the bench. But the biggest reason perhaps that we win on the environment is around about 6 or 7 mechanisms that come out from our first two speaker speeches. Things like talking about how R&D budgets work, that like the responses that we get from affirmative are characteristically ungenerous. Things like people still need energy, but like, yeah, we can have better energy technologies. Those comes from things like budget surpluses within companies, come from things like subsidies, which we can do better. Which is why at the end of this, we win on their most important metric by perhaps even more than we win on the metric which we introduce into this debate, inequity, and they never fully engage with. Vote negative.
Great, let's have affirmative reply.
For the delay. Starting in 3, 2, 1. I'm going to start this reply on the terms of the negative team. The crux of their win strategy appears to be governments will have to do this in a way that causes a recession that is driven by the increased costs of goods. The mechanism for increased costs of goods is actually incredibly vague. It is that goods will increase in price because demand is up. This is incoherent. Our strategy is to organically reduce demand by doing things like stopping planned obsolescence, which they notably ignore from the beginning of First Affirmative, and strawman our cases. We're just going to do some ad campaigns. That's a part of it. But there are also like actual policies that undergird this and aggressively campaigning for voluntary reduction. As Eugene explains, though, the fundamental logic of this does not make any sense for reasons that they give. If demand has decreased, which they push on us hard, and obviously is something we defend, the price will decrease because companies will have the incentive to recoup their profits somehow. Incidentally, that's also why welfare doesn't decrease in our world. Notably, because we have the fiat power to say we would not implement it this way, but also more powerfully because welfare is in every incentive of the boogeyman they think exists in this debate, because they have the incentive to lobby it. In essence, if you believe in this debate, their fundamental like bottleneck, which is that businesses now respond by wanting to recoup their costs, they will respond by decreasing the costs of goods so that that happens. So at this stage, their economic strategy to winning the debate collapses because their mechanisms about inequality, because their mechanisms about the housing crisis do not occur in the way they say it is. Third negative fan waves at this explanation and appears to basically concede our argument here that the price of goods will decrease in the way we say, but instead they will use financial instruments with no further explanation. What does this mean? You clearly cannot weigh it. They make the argument at about like 8 minutes of third negative that this will lead to lower employment in the developed world. I think that's pretty late to credit it as having some influence in this debate. But if you believe the price of goods decreases in the way we say, that has a much, much, much more enormous impact, and welfare doesn't decrease in the way we say. But also in developing nations, that doesn't happen, the reason we give. But the margin becomes enormous when you consider the debate on our terms, which is on the question of the environment, which they never really want to debate much more because I think First Affirmative is pretty clear we're the team that takes this question by both horns and tries to actually deal with it. Really, I think they're confused here. They burden push us to go harder and they go, well, we'll do a little bit softer and we'll do things like funding green energy. We explain from First Affirmative why subsidies are not enough, because there is an underlying enormous incentive for consumerism, for demand, that means that it doesn't work, that it isn't a sufficient barrier to overcome the current capture of extractive industries. But overwhelmingly now, we curb the ability of extractive industries to compete, something they cannot defend if they want their other impacts in the debate to work like they say they do. They say that there will be less R&D now because you have less excess profit to invest. This argument was always incoherent, right? Like deprioritizing industries that produce environmental external harms like fossil fuels, decreasing their profits, and increasing the profits of green technology firms and renewable industry would not lead to fossil fuel companies now investing their profit in their competitors. That never makes sense. Our strategy in this debate at that point is just logically prior to that, right? Because if countries go underwater, if the world is producing huge negative external externalities that massively increase the cost of goods, because it's harder to sow crops, because there's plastic in the water that makes people sick, and that occurs for billions of people, including and especially in the developing world, then you can't believe they win on economics, because they spend 100 years, that's enormous, destroying the climate and trading it off with growth. They can't pop that bullet in this debate. It was ridiculous for them to try. We're the team that wins on both issues. Vote for Affirmative.
Great, thanks for that. Please leave the breakout room. We'll be taking a few minutes to discuss.
Thanks for the debate, everyone.
Thanks, guys. Good debate. Thank you.